whose links with Japan we meet Nihoni Habataku Harandogen.
Strange and diverse place. Much of the enjoyment or interest in traveling or living abroad is simply being in a place that is different from home. For foreigners, whom the Japanese call gaijin, Japan is, by definition, a very foreign society. Even years of living and working there may not be enough. Just as you think you are getting to know Japan and the Japanese, you realize just how little you really know. Irish people, through force of historic circumstance, are possibly more adaptable than most in strange and foreign places. But even with the tradition and folk memory of emigration, we Irish find it difficult to settle in a country as different as Japan.
For example, you start with a language that is very, very foreign to our European world. You start with a way of living, a way of eating, a way of greeting people, a way of walking, a way of conducting your everyday life that is not just different, but I would say in more cases than not, alien to what we have been used to in Ireland.
But the Japanese language, with its three writing systems, is only one of the difficult barriers that face the Irish in Japan. Crowded and cramped conditions, a ritualistic and formal social life, two different religions, a type of cuisine that seems to rely heavily on raw fish and rice, a society that is rigid and hierarchical, that is still almost feudal in its attitude towards women, the less well-off and the unskilled. A society that cherishes very young children, but later forces them through one of the most competitive and pressurized systems of schooling and third-level education in the world. Anne Delaney is a young Irish woman, a single parent who has spent more than 12 years in Japan. As a gaijin, a woman and a single parent, her life there encompasses many of the difficulties facing foreigners. Anne came to Japan on a scholarship to study for a year and a half. Her specialization was sociolinguistics, so her study of the differences between the language spoken by men and women has made her an acute observer of life. As a single parent, Anne is in a tiny minority in Japan. Well over 90% of Japanese people marry, often through arrangements made by their families. But the divorce rate is increasing rapidly. In their mid-40s, many Japanese find themselves with their children grown up and little else to keep them together.
Well, sexual discrimination is huge. And it all centers around the family system. I mean, feminists in Japan see their biggest enemy as being the family system and the emperor system, the imperialist system, which has the emperor sitting on top of this immense clan family system, whereby the laws of kinship are such that it's the same as the group society in Japan. You belong to a certain group. You belong to your family within that society. And if you start moving outside of that, you're going to face big difficulties. And the way the social security system works, that as long as you have family, they're not going to give you benefits. They're going to do their best not to give you benefits. So anybody who doesn't have family will be eligible for benefits, but those benefits are minimal. So, for example, in the case of single parents, which I am, If I were a Japanese single parent, I'd have a very difficult time because as far as social security is concerned, there's minimal support because they expect that you're going to fall back on your family who are going to have to support you. And that's why the problem of the aged population in Japan has become such a big one, because nuclear family now are living in places that are far too small to be able to cope with taking care of the elder generation.
Feminism was late arriving in Japan, and strong feudal traditions mean it has much ground to make up. Big companies like to hire young single women living with their parents, but as soon as they get married, they prefer them to give up working. Only one in every 100 managers is a woman, and they are usually women who have had to choose between marriage and a successful career. Women's earnings, in many cases, are only half those of men. But changes in legislation, increasing access to foreign influences through travel, and the mass information media mean Japan faces an explosion of women power over the coming years. But though she is critical of the general lack of support for single parents in Japan, Anne Delaney concedes that her experience in sending her daughter Mina to nursery school has been good.
I was very lucky. They took her in from 4 months. Probably because I was alone and I could continue working. So they have a very long day. She starts at 9 o'clock and she goes till 6, which gives me almost a full day at the office that I work in. It's a semi-private, semi-state nursery, and I think compared to maybe in Ireland, the fees are very reasonable. They're about what would be the equivalent of £80 a month, and that's for 5.5 day care with meals included. So I wouldn't have been able to survive if I didn't have that kind of backup support. And the quality is excellent. The care is excellent. The birthday party is a big event every month. It celebrates the birthdays of all the kids whose birthday it is that month. The teachers work very hard. They put on this little show for them. They do that little song every time, and then the teachers put on a little puppet show for them, and then they have their lunch, and then they go home or have their sleep. So the kids look forward to it. Mina looks forward to it a great deal. They all bring a little present and they all exchange presents. So that would be a once a month event. Yeah. It's again the idea of the individual, and whether the emphasis is put on the individual or whether the emphasis is put on the group. And of course, from a very early age, it's going to be group. The emphasis is going to be on the group. And the children aren't really encouraged to be individualistic or to be creative, because group teamwork, not sticking out, not being different, working together. So there's very positive sides to this as well, but very negative, because, I mean, I feel that she's not getting enough stimulation. You know, she's not encouraged creatively.
But for Mina and the other children in her class, these are the only carefree days they will spend in Japan's schooling system. At 6, they go into primary school, then middle school, followed by high school. When children finish high school, they face extremely competitive exams for university. Father Jerry Burke is an Irish Jesuit who first came to Japan more than 40 years ago. He has first-hand experience of the pressures in Japanese high schools and universities.
The vast majority of students plan to and hope to enter university. They really get nowhere in society unless they have been to university. And when they graduate from university, many of them get very humble jobs in companies, especially the women, I have to say. They're office girls and that sort of thing. But there is the possibility then of proceeding up along the line. The other great difference, I would say, between Japan and Ireland, at least the Ireland of my time and of Sink Street compared to high school that I knew down in Kamakura, was that you had to drive the students in Ireland to study, but here they drive you, kind of. They're very zealous, very diligent, There's a great fervor. It's not, I don't know if it's so much a fervor for knowledge as much a realization that unless they make it, they're finished, and that it's a competitive society and it's the survival of the fittest.
When Mary McGann, a teacher, went to live with a Japanese family as part of the homestay system, her first major worry was the fact that much of the food was raw. But this was not the only strange custom Mary encountered.
Every day they have this custom where they cook the rice. They have two little rice dishes which they fill religiously, and they have a little corner in the house which is like a little shrine, and it's in memory of the grandparents who have died. And every day at mealtime they go in and they ring this little bell twice and clap their hands and bow in front of the shrine and put in the rice dishes, and sometimes they also put in some fruit. And I found that really, really strange.
Many of the people Father Jerry Burke works with in university have no formal religious background. He finds, however, that they have a basic desire to be able to relate to other people and to help them. And he finds that very religious in a fundamental sense. Of Japan's population of 125 million, only about one in every 100 professes the Christian faith. In a country where ritual and formality are so much at the heart of the way people work and relax, it is not easy and probably not wise to try to stand aloof. But joining in, doing things the Japanese way, can be an enjoyable as well as enlightening experience. Niall O'Flaherty was the first gaijin to work for his company, Ork. He was treated, he felt, like an honored guest, and Japanese lessons every morning from his boss were a great help in settling in. With his colleague, Paul Joyce, Niall has become a dedicated practitioner of the traditional Japanese martial art of kendo. It's a bit like a Japanese person coming to Ireland and successfully taking up hurling or Gaelic football. But for these two young Irishmen, it was a key to knowing Japan and its people better.
Doing it, and I was treating it as a sport, the same as soccer or anything else. But I don't think that you can. You have to take into account that there's a cultural thing behind it, and granted there is a military tradition. The police all do it out here, it's sort of standard for the police. But I treat it more in the way of a cultural thing than a military thing. So it doesn't bother me, and I think it adds more to the sport if you're cognizant of the cultural side of it, that you actually do it getting ready properly as opposed to just putting everything on and then doing the sport. Granted that there might be some religious overtones to it, I'm not sure, but you show respect to your teachers, and granted it's, you bow to the shrine, but again that's respect to the spirit of the people who have gone before you, as opposed to a god figure or anything. So again, I think it's part of it. It's all part of it. It's part of the cultural side of it.
Usually back home I'm more used to singing the Fury Brothers and things like that, but since I came to Japan I just can't get my hands on any sort of songs in that area. And being as the Beatles are quite popular in Japan, I've recently become one of their greatest fans. So I tend to do a lot of karaoke with my Japanese friends. Not so much with the Irish people, I think we just kind of sing to each other, but it's quite interesting, so you should, if you do get the opportunity, try it out. Now I'm a better man than I used to be.
like kendo, is a Japanese word that has passed into everyday use in Ireland. Pachinko, however, is a word we are not familiar with.
Outside, there's a lot of lights, a lot of noise, and you hear this sound like ching, 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 ching. It's basically a game like the balls come up from the side, they fly up, and you have a handle which controls the speed of the ball comes up. It's all little holes and slots, so if the ball falls down the hole, you get more balls come out, and it's as many balls as you can collect. So a lot of people go in there for the day, sit down with their little basket and see how many balls you get. I went one day and I made a full tray and I said, great, I'll see what I can get for this. And in these areas, you go up to a counter and you hand in the tray of your winnings, which are little small silver balls. And there's all food goods, cigarettes, and washing powder, you name it. It's like a supermarket and you can pick what you want. But I heard you could get money. So I asked for, how do I get money? And they gave me a small little packet about this size. It's like a little packet of sweets. And I said, what do I do with it? And she says, come on out the back. So I went around the back and I went out across the road. And there was a small cabin. It's about, just about like a, where one person could fit in. And you hand in your little box of sweets and you get out 2 or 3 cents. So I thought that was very interesting. In Japan, gambling is illegal, but they come around it in this way.
That Japanese ambivalence towards cash winnings at the national pastime pachinko, Thomas also found when he, like many another good Irish person abroad, inquired about the nearest race course.
Horse racing in Japan is a little frowned upon. I was out here for about a month and I was asking people in work, where's the nearest horse racing track? And they were saying, not really sure it is now. So I asked other people and nobody seemed to know. And I asked them, have you ever been? And they were saying no. So then I asked a very good friend and he says, horse racing in Japan has a very low image. And he says, I'd advise you not to go. So I wanted to go anyway, so I eventually found it and went. And there was a lot of strange people there.
So with a little perseverance, you can find the traditional pastimes of Ireland even in Japan. Or if you are really homesick, you can import the sports and pastimes from home.
We've got a very good record. In the 5 years the team has been in existence here in Tokyo, we've only suffered one defeat at the hands of Japanese opposition. So we've had a very good record over that period of time. Today we were playing Mitsubishi Heavy Industries in a just a friendly game against one of the best Japanese teams, probably. So this is the first time the Irish team has played them. And I think we were a little lucky today to get a 1-0 victory.
At the moment, it's the only Irish soccer team, but at one stage, there was another team down in the Osaka-Kyoto area. And we used to have a six-monthly exchange visit up and down. But I think now we are the only team here. It takes a lot of work, a lot of phone calls, a lot of organizing with Japanese sides and so on. But it's worth it. It's good fun.
It was a camera magazine.
An average travel to a game is between an hour and 2 hours. If it's under an hour, you're very lucky, and it's very unusual. But quite often, you travel maybe 3 hours to a game.
I was out here the longest, and there was no real running club out here, and nowhere to meet. Like, there was nothing to do on most weekends, so there was a few of us interested in running at the start. I mean, I used to run with a Japanese club who used to train here behind us. That was about 2.5 years ago now. And just more and more Irish people became interested in running. So we decided that we'd try to get a club together. And like before that, we had been very successful in races, in relay type, they call them Ekidens over here. Without even doing any training at all, we were able to pull away from the competitors. So we had about 4 or 5 real serious runners. So you put a group together and we have a lot. I mean, there's a great interest in running in the Irish group because it's a sport that you can do in Japan. You don't need any equipment for. Like, if you play soccer, you need a ground. You can run anywhere.
Years ago, there were fewer than 200 Irish people in Japan, and many of those were missionaries. Now there are more than 1,000 in a wide variety of occupations. Paradoxically, far from being swamped in the tens of millions of people living around Tokyo, their still tiny numbers actually help the Irish keep in touch, if they want to.
As more and more Irish came to Japan, we realized that there was a need for some kind of organization so that we could organize ourselves use all of our resources to the best use and organise various events, sporting events, social events. For that reason, and to act as a support group for the Irish in Japan, the Irish Network is set up. It has developed a long way from those beginnings 2.5 years ago, and now it is the largest Irish organisation in Japan. And at the moment, its main aims are to promote the interests of the Irish in Japan and to promote Ireland and the Irish within Japan. And we do our best to develop links back to Ireland and with other similar Irish networks around the world. And we have links with all of the universities back in Ireland. For me, as a member of the Irish Network, I rely on them to supply me with information from Ireland and information of events that are happening in Japan. A newsletter, which we call Feedback, is published once a month. We also organize various seminars so that I can learn of skills and information that are difficult to get here in Japan. For example, we have marketing seminars, we have seminars on the Japanese language, we have seminars on the Japanese experience, where Irish people who've been in Japan for a long time will talk to other members of the network in a formal gathering and discuss the problems that they had and how they overcame them.
Father Cathal Gallagher is critical of the Irish network being too Tokyo-orientated, a point Sheila Ní Earraig does not concede.
We've become aware of this problem, if you want to call it a problem.
No possibility.
And we must remember also the network is a very young organisation. We are very aware of this and we are therefore trying to actually promote the network as an open forum, an open membership. And we are certainly trying our very best to broaden our activities to include people from all walks of life.
After more than 10 years each in Japan, they still share memories and a love of Ireland.
Vasan hen na holdanya bi hanikis gwydor na smwynion yr gwydor a hanfled yn y hil agos, wel, ta se ffyr dwsa, ta se ffyr da chile na holo es y flien na smwytion tu yr gwydor agos yr nad dwi'n nis y wale yr holter, yr gwelig agos se ar jang y ffein sy'n gwelig ar jang y is yn gwelig tanga ar grichia agos ar nwchwys agos ar nairart.
Memories of Ireland remain strong. In a Japanese garden on a summer's day, Gwen Delaney evokes memories of another garden.
Down by the Sally Gardens, my love and I did meet. She passed the Sally Gardens with little snow-white feet. She bid me take love easy as the grass grows on the trees. But I, being young,
we have a traditional Japanese style apartment, which as I say, our bedroom is not big enough for a bed, so we'd sleep Japanese style on futons, which is quite comfortable. And after that, I describe it as a one-cat apartment, meaning that you'd only swing one cat in it. Now, it's very small, it's very compact, but it's comfortable. And really, after living in a Japanese apartment, you'd sort of say, in Ireland, you know, we expect too much.
But we're fairly lucky where we are because we live near a river, so it's not so bad there, but you get very tired of it every now and then. You just want to go into a big spacious apartment or a big spacious shop with nobody around, or get onto a train where there's nobody sitting on the seats or clamoring for the one seat that's left.
Tiny living quarters and the constant pressures of large crowds mark big differences between Japan and Ireland. The easygoing Irish have to get used to a way of life where even the most straightforward of social appointments must be made weeks in advance. Carol Lanigan has worked in Japan for several extended periods during the last 10 years.
I think you gain, no matter what culture you come in contact with. But, I mean, obviously the fact that Japan is one of the rising powers in the world is something that would be of great importance. And I think one of the important things I'd like to say is that I wouldn't want to think of it just being in terms of facilitating communication in business, because I think we have a lot to learn from each other culturally on every level, not just Japan as an economic power, because I think that's sometimes overemphasized by the media in the West.
Having first gone to Japan in 1951, Father Jerry Burke probably knows the country better than any Irishman. He remains cautious in his assessment of this complex and challenging society.
I find Japanese society a very oppressive society. Oppressive in the sense of being pressurized to produce, even in the role of a professor in the university. So much is expected of you. You're expected to take a heavy load of classes. You're expected to be, I'm director of the counseling center at the same time. Up to a year or two, I was director of a school of counseling that we ran here. And they expect you to do all that, and at the same time to do research, to produce, and that. And I once complained about that, and they said, I was told I was thinking too much like an American. And I said, I'm not an American, I'm an Irishman. I'm not talking as an Irishman either. I said, I'm speaking as a human being. I think you cannot really be fully human in a situation like that. And that's what I find most difficult.
Bustling, largely urbanized, the world's second most powerful economy. Its population of more than 120 million people work hard, and their earnings and savings make Japan one of the biggest consumer markets in the world. The contrast with Ireland in size, economic power, and culture couldn't be greater. Yet despite all the differences, there are more and more signs of growing links between Ireland and Japan. In a country as big and as rich as Japan, even a small slice of the economic action means proportionately more to a country like Ireland. Against the odds, Irish companies have made the breakthrough.
Donnelly Mirrors Limited is one of the world's leading manufacturers of automotive mirrors. We're based in Naas in County Kildare, and we employ about 300 people there. We first began our business in Japan in the early 70s, exporting day-night prismatic mirrors, just like this one here. Now we have been selling consistently in Japan for almost 17 years, and we have managed to achieve a market share of almost 55% of the Japanese automotive prismatic mirror market. This basically means that one car in two made in Japan carries one of our inside mirrors.
There are vast differences of language and culture between Japan and Ireland, and a distance of 8,000 miles, but many new links have been forged in recent years. Trade in both directions has increased four times over, and Japan is now Ireland's ninth biggest export customer. There have been a number of state and official visits by leaders of both countries. Gradually, the doors are opening.
This is a large market that has been involved in market opening, and that market opening process is continuing. It is, as you said, a difficult market, but at the same time, the success of Irish companies here show that you can, with time and effort, break into this market, and the yield for the investment is a very good one, and we have a good product to sell.
For hundreds of years, Japan remained a medieval society, with its ports and shores closed to all but a handful of foreigners. In the 19th century, Western imperial powers threatened Japan. A group of samurai restored the Emperor Meiji to the throne and opened Japan to foreign trade, investment, and cultural influence. In a complete reversal of emphasis, wealthy and educated Japanese adopted Western manners and culture. The wheel had turned full circle by the earlier part of this century, when Japan made bloody forays of conquest into the rest of Asia, believing that this was the way to capture markets and win economic power.
Japan is becoming the dominant economic force at world level. Since the Second World War, when the Japanese decided that the future for them lay in economic development and to compete in economic terms rather than what used to be in the past, using a military base to secure economic progress.
The biggest investor in Ireland is the United States, and will probably continue in that position for a long time. Japan is coming up rapidly. And in many areas of technology, Japan is ahead of the United States. So if we're going for quality of technology, quality of production techniques, then we've got to be with the Japanese, and we've got to have the Japanese presence in Ireland.
But getting to know Japan is like peeling an onion. The more you learn about it, the more layers there are to be revealed and taken into account. There are many Irish success stories in Japan, but everyone who is making it there agrees on two things. You must get to know your market well, and you must deliver a quality product at a competitive price.
Royal Tire of China started to concentrate on the Japanese market 4 years ago, and the actual market itself takes a long time to actually develop. And we were very, very lucky to, in the beginning, to identify an extremely good distributor, which is very important for Irish manufacturers wanting to do business here in Japan.
Ireland is not very well known in Japan as a country, and many Irish companies do not have the advantage of being household names here. So basically, an Irish company succeeds in Japan because of quality of service and consistently high quality. I think to put it in one sentence, you would say, never promise what you can't deliver, and always deliver what you promise. And if better, if possible, deliver even more than that. If you do that, basically, then you will succeed.
The Japanese are a very cash-rich society, but they are a very discerning customer. Japanese people understand, first of all, the medium that we work with, porcelain. It's been in their own culture. And lace, they love lace. They have lace everywhere, even in the taxis. They look for quality, very high quality, very good service from you, and if you can give them that, I think anybody here can be very successful.
first thing you see is all the colours in the lights. Now those colours are put into the original mix for the lights. But only the person who mixed it knows what it is. It doesn't show up until after the fire. It's a 5-day kiln, and when they come out, the figurine looks like this. The cotton lace has now disintegrated, and you're left with porcelain lace.
In a marketplace as complex as Japan, good communications are essential.
Sometimes Japanese requirement looks strange or new or opposite, different from European traditional requirement. But Irish company study the background of the requirement. Then they can achieve how to control the client's requirement. And barrier of language is still very high, even though we can speak some poor English. But true communication is usually very difficult. So Irish people must have ears to listen what is the requirement patiently.
Above all, as always, language is the essence of communication. For example, it takes Japanese schoolchildren 6 years to master 881 characters of the Japanese writing system in order to pass their first-level examination.
One difficulty here in Tokyo, of course, is the language. We identified this several years ago, and we sent a number of people on intensive Japanese courses here. In fact, my colleague Kevin O'Halloran speaks Japanese fluently and has done a number of presentations in Japanese here in Tokyo and in Osaka and other areas.
Any Irish organization or company which wants to market in Japan needs to have either a Japanese speaker or needs to have employ a Japanese person who can establish the contacts and build credibility with the customers.
But whether it's in Japanese or English, the encouraging message is that more and more Irish companies can make it and are making it in Japan, even becoming household names. Not bad going for a small country thousands of miles away from the marketplace.
We're very much satisfied with Irish products. Like Inchman Knitwear, Diners Club of Japan have been selling their products for 2 years, and their logo mark getting really famous and famous every year. And now we can sell those sweaters easily because that logo is famous one right now.
There is very much a move in the luxury end of the market towards natural fibers, such as Irish linen, which is well recognized in this market. These are premium products, but the designs must be suitable for this market. This means undertaking research into the styles and sizes that the Japanese demand. But also presentation is absolutely paramount in this market. The standard of packaging, presentation, is just superb. It's way ahead of anything that we even have in Europe.
Japan itself is a very premium-conscious market. We are competing here with major global brands, so therefore we have to target very specifically how we can address the Japanese consumer. We have looked at a number of segments of the market. The department store business here is obviously extremely important. A year ago, we ran a very successful Irish promotion with Isetan, for instance. At the moment now, we're looking very closely at the mail order business because this enables us to research the market and to do a lot of background work and then develop into a very specific and focused segment of the market.
At the Osaka Expo 90, Ireland made a prize-winning impact with its Garden of Ireland. The garden's design was inspired by the 5,000-year-old tomb at Newgrange in County Meath, and it includes replicas of the kind of prehistoric dwellings widely found in Ireland. Two of the leading members of Japan's imperial family, Prince Hitachi Nomiya and Princess Hanako, have visited the Garden of Ireland, marking Japanese interest in and approval of Irish culture at the highest level.
Mm-hmm.
But the calm and greenery of Ireland are in marked contrast to Japan's overcrowded urban environment. Being big, populous, and rich brings its own problems. Leisure facilities are now being encouraged. This magnificent racetrack in Tokyo is serviced by its own specially built rail link. On Nippon Derby Day, it easily accommodates over 250,000 people. For the Japanese, golf is a passion, but very few get to play on a golf course. For most, this is golf Japanese style. But an even more abiding passion for Japanese is playing pachinko. To unwind after work, people from all walks of life make their way to the crowded and noisy pachinko parlors. Bright lights of Tokyo at night are not all they may seem.
Any good sessions here in Tokyo?
Sure, yes, there's always a good session in Tokyo. I'm going to do one now here on the third floor. You come up?
Yeah, sure.
Come on, sure.
That Japan is a stressed society or a stressful society. Japanese people tend to make the most of their non-working hours, as in even in the train, you'll find that their eyes are closed and they're basically, you might imagine they were asleep, but they're just making the most of their free time. Irish people would tend to be more active about their free time, and you'll find Irish people in the hot spots and the not so hot spots around Tokyo.
Increasingly, young Japanese are looking abroad for holidays and leisure time, and there is plenty of scope for Ireland to capture part of this growing market.
Una atar.
Una atar.
As part of its opening up to the world, Japan has set itself a target of getting 10 million Japanese to travel abroad each year as tourists.
The Irish writers, such as William Butler Yeats, James Joyce, Oscar Wilde, Bernard Shaw, Jonathan Swift, are well known throughout the world, let alone Japan, while Japanese authors are hardly known in Ireland. Speaking about Lafcadio Hearn, he has been hardly known here in Ireland, although everybody in Japan knows about him. I still remember some of the passages from his work. He was Irish, but he became Japanese by choice, marrying a Japanese woman and adopting her family name, Koizumi. So he is known as Koizumi Yakumo in Japan, and in a way, a cultural bridge linking our two great nations.
But the traveling isn't all one way. In recent years, FOSS, the Irish government's training authority, has operated an overseas graduate program to Japan through third-level colleges and institutions throughout Ireland, and has sent more than 350 graduates to live and work in Japan, learning not only its language, but also the secrets of its commercial success.
I applied from Queen's University Belfast and was interviewed by Mr. Yamada in Dublin and had the job within 2 days. I was really signed up to go to Japan before I thought a lot about it. I'm part of the FOSS program. I came here a year and 7.5 months ago, and I'm here in Japan Technical Software, the company I'm working in Sapporo on the Northern Ireland, Hokkaido. And I was working on a COBOL project for a year, and for the last 7.5 months I've been working with them, computer graphics and animation.
If I forget all the language, which is quite possible, at least I feel that at the end of my time in Japan, I'll have an understanding of the Japanese psyche, that I'll be able to communicate with them, that when I come against a problem, that I know what's behind the problem, and that I can work with them towards a solution. I think that I can use that back in Ireland, or I can use it anywhere.
Education is a two-way process. Not only are there Irish people in Japan sponsored by FOSS, but young Japanese students are now studying in Ireland. The Sundai Gakuen School, established in Tokyo, has located the Sundai Ireland International School in County Kildare for Japanese children living in Ireland and continental Europe. The school offers the full Japanese curriculum, an important incentive for Japanese businesses to locate in Ireland.
I established a new school in Ireland last year. For the strong request by Irish government and ITA. And first of all, Ireland is an English-speaking country, and so strong friendship between Japan and Ireland, and very convenient situation in Europe. Japan students want to study English, but in Japan it's not good. But in Ireland, I think fine English-speaking country.
Wherever there is business to be done, you will find bankers. Along with London and New York, Tokyo is one of the top three world financial powerhouses. Indeed, the early opening of the Tokyo stock market often sets the trend for the day in the rest of the world, and major Irish banks are represented there and are battling successfully for a share of the action.
for the remaining part of this decade, right up to the year 2000, the decisions being made in Tokyo and the importance of the Tokyo market is certainly unassailable from our point of view. That's certainly the belief of Bank of Ireland, and it's a key reason why we're here, to be, as it were, a listening post for the bank in its future development and in its deciding on policy.
Over recent years, there has been increasing awareness and contact between our two countries, and I believe there is great potential for the future. Ireland itself is small as a market, but Japanese companies see it as an easy access to a huge European market with a population of 350 million for their products. On the other hand, Irish companies have yet to penetrate the Japanese market more deeply, but there is great potential for their high-quality luxury goods there if they will only try a little harder.
In recent years, Japan has come under strong criticism from its trading partners, especially the United States and the European Community, for failing to open up its markets to foreign goods, services, and investments. Stung by this criticism, Japan is the only country with an official policy of actually encouraging imports, which seems to be working. Japan's embarrassingly large trade surplus with the rest of the world is down. To encourage imports opens up huge opportunities for Irish companies, with the possibility of up to 1,500 firms eventually becoming involved. JETRO, the official Japanese trade organization, using a computer link, can put Irish business directly in contact with potential Japanese customers.
With regard to international trade, overall Irish exports exceed imports by a substantial margin, which attests to the healthy nature of the Irish economy. The trade between our two countries is in Japan's favor, but as the Japanese government resolutely aims at balancing its huge surplus by expanding its volume of imports from all over the world and will spare no efforts in helping the Irish to sell more of its products to Japan so that a balance can be attained.
Those Japanese that do know Ireland and have visited Ireland relate to us extremely favorably. They know we're a very small country. They know we're a very friendly country. We're beginning to make an impact, a small impact over here. And I think through the promotion of Irish products with strong branded Irish background image, we can reinforce that situation.
In Dublin's fair city, where the girls are so pretty, I first set my eyes on sweet Molly Malone. As she wheeled her wheelbarrow through streets broad and narrow, crying,
next week's programme can be seen at the slightly later time of 11 o'clock.